I'll be covering in this part, in this session, about graphs and how we get the optimization and what are the new kind of framework objects and data objects that we have and various APIs that we have to kind of expose. I think if you finish the exercise one with Terry, I think he pretty much covered all the fundamentals that you need to know. And also, so Nico here. Is it clear? Okay. Yeah, I think he also get exposed to Qt, so you're all familiar with Qt, people who are not used to Linux, so that's a good thing. So let's get started. I'm gonna skip some other slides here because it's covered in Neil's slides and Kari's before. Y graphs, we all know most API-based, the limitations with the API-based functions. I'm just gonna skip that. Now, what are the big opportunities we have with the OpenVX graphs is basically first is to fuse a kernel. So while accessing the image, there are many things. You want to do it at the same time. For example, if you want to do a Sobel gradient and you want to do square root of function simultaneously, you can just pull the data. Since the data is already available, you can kind of fuse both the operations at once so that you're not kind of transferring data back and forth inside an implementation. And you can also process images in kind of a tiles. So you can just fix an implementation, can choose to pull a data like, you know, 256 by 256. Within that neighborhood, it can do all the operations. And you have a lot of optimizations that happen in the graphics. I think very similar ones happen. You can use it here for the imaging. And also, once you have a lot of work available, let's say if you have a larger image, and you have multiple hardware units available, underlying implementation can now try to take advantage of all the available hardware in the system. And there's a lot more opportunities in there available. So when it comes to this session, we're gonna take video feature tracker as an example. And you're kind of already familiar with this example on the screen where you got an input image, we convert that to grayscale, and then we run a Harris corner detector, which gets us key point array, and then we just display them. You're familiar with this one. What we're gonna do in this session is take the same example, build a graph to perform the same operation, same functionality using a graph. And there's one thing I want you to notice, which is here I put T equal to N, just to say that you know time is equal to now, so that you have a variance between data corresponding to current and data corresponding to the previous one. We're gonna use that notation. So I just put T equal to N, so we're gonna use T equal to N minus one as a previous reference. For feature tracker, what we're gonna be using is there's a Lucas Kernades algorithm for feature tracking that's a built-in kernel in OpenVX called Optical Flow, and which basically takes the key points that are in the previous frame, and then it's gonna compute how it changed looking at the current and previous delta frame, try to see how much it changed. So it's gonna run much faster than Harris. So that's one kernel that we're gonna use. As part of doing that, what we need to do is we need to keep a copy of the current set of key points and the key points from the previous frame. So OpenVX has a framework data type called VX delay, which kind of works like, you know, it's in signal processing if you have a delay element where you have T equal to zero, T equal to minus one refers to the previous time sample. It's very similar notation. We're gonna use that object. And in addition to that, the optical flow from Lucas Kanade, it uses a pyramid of images. So what it does is instead of processing all the pixels at a fully detailed high resolution, it just kind of takes the image, scales it down like a pyramid, right? Let's take a resolution, you divide by half and half and half, you can go a number of levels you want, so that it picks the lowest level, coarse level, and then it kind of does a small search so that it becomes computationally faster. And after that, it keeps refining to the next level. So that way, it kind of achieves a lot of performance improvement in there. So we're going to be looking at a new data object called pyramids, which is not just an image. It's kind of a series of images with a particular relationship with them, scale up or scale down. In this particular case, each one is kind of a half the dimension of the different level. And we're gonna need this pyramid, one for the current and one for the previous. That means we're gonna maintain two buffers, swap them back and forth. So we're gonna have a delay of pyramids there. So two objects that we're gonna talk about is delay and pyramids. Now, if you, in order to do the optical flow, initially you need to have a starting set of key points. So for that, we're going to run Harris corner on the frame zero, which is going to give us key points. In addition to that, we also need to compute pyramids, because that is needed when you actually run the optical flow. So we're going to build two sets of graphs, one for just doing the Harris and the, first we're going to do a graph which is going to just do the Harris and the pyramid. You can kind of see the nodes that are it's going to have. We're going to call it as graph Harris so that it has the word Harris in there, too easy to remember. And another one is going to be an optical flow, which has to do the same thing, taking RGB, converting to the gray, and then computing a pyramid, and then looking at the running the optical flow. Now, in addition to just running these two graphs, there's one more thing you need to do. You need to make sure you kind of swap the buffers, previous one to current one. That way, at a given instance of time, you have the buffers that are correspond to the previous frame available. The buffers we need are, again, the key point array and the pyramid that corresponds to the previous frame. Okay, so let's look into some of the API calls in the OpenVX and how they look for the graph specifically. You're already familiar with the create context. We did that in the exercise one. And creating an image, in this particular case, just take a input and output, which are happen to be UI. Now, we need to create a graph. So there is an API call, VX create graph, which basically takes the context. So the graph is going to sit inside a given a context. And you can also create search and buffers. Kerry has alluded to this briefly in his presentation, which are virtual. That means you're telling the framework that I'm not going to access these objects, right? That way, you don't need physically existing anywhere. An implementation can choose whatever it wants to do. It can keep it in a remote hardware that sits that it cannot doesn't have access to it. Or it might not even keep a buffer for it. It might just be just a, it may just use a register for it. It could just be a temporary intermediate buffer sitting in a register somewhere. So the way you do that is there's a word keyword called virtual. So if it's an image, you create virtual image. If it's an array, you create virtual array. If it's a pyramid, you create virtual pyramid. The word virtual is meant for that. By declaring virtual, you're just saying that next time you call access, you might get an error saying this buffer doesn't exist. So now once you create all the intermediate buffers, the next thing is within a graph, you can instantiate a node. A node is a particular instance of a kernel, and you all know already there are 41 kernels. You can specifically say within a graph, you want to instantiate a set of nodes in a particular order, and you can specify the dependency. In this particular case, you have this kernel called F1, so you instantiate a node which takes the input, and then output is an intermediate one, and similarly, you're instantiating another node which just gets the F2. Once you kind of build a graph here, we're going to look at much more detailed examples, but I just want to give you the idea of a node and virtual buffer here. Once you create a graph, once you think you've constructed the graph, now you can tell the implementation saying, okay, I have these are all the set of operations that I'm going to be performing on set of my input data to produce output, and you're asking the implementation to go check to see if everything is right and then see if it can do any optimizations. So this verify graph is more like not a runtime. You're not going to be running for every frame. You just schedule it once. So if there is any just-in-time compilation it has to do, if it has to initialize any OpenCL code or any firmware-specific one, any hard fixed function-specific one, it can do all the optimizations to the graph and specific optimizations. And verify graph will basically tell you if it's successful or failure, whether it can do it or not, whether it can has the capability to handle it or not. So you should check for the errors. And once you have a graph verified, now you're ready to run the graph. So all you do is initialize the input buffers, say process graph, and then look at the outputs, right? And then keep doing that in a loop. That's kind of a flow in a nutshell for the whole one. Okay. So before going further, let's start doing a small exercise here so that you get into the code. I'm going to switch to see if I have it. Yeah, okay. So you're going to be looking at the exercise 2. The way to switch to the exercise 2 is you pick, you click on the default here on the left side, and you see all the projects that are available show up. So I would say just select on the exercise 2, and that makes it, now when you execute, it is going to be compiling and running the exercise 2. Just to be sure, I'm just running it. And the fact that you don't see any key points on there, that means you're not doing the exercise 1. Right? That's the only way to know this, right? Does anybody have a problem with running the exercise 2? Okay. So you go to the left side, see you have this icon here. You click here, it opens up. You should see exercise 1, exercise 2. And then select exercise 2. It won't go away, just click somewhere else and then say, you can simply run. Okay, so the next thing is we, in the exercise2.cpp, I have that open already here. You want to start looking for to-do. You can just press Control F, to-do step, which kind of gets you to, you can search. So we're going to jump straight to step 3. Let's ignore step 1 and 2. Let's go to straight step 3. You can see it on the screen here. What we want to do is be able to create a graph and create some of the intermediate buffer. So at least we do the first step of the using the API. So we just uncomment the graph Harris. So for the Harris, I already created the function. For tracking, you need to add the function. So what you do, you just go here, type VX create graph. Sorry. And we want to make sure we always check for if the graph creation is successful. So I'm just going to specify object for tracking. Once it is done, I'm just going to try to run it. I didn't see any error, so that means graph creation is successful. Right. Is anybody stuck in this stage? Please let me know. So once we're done with step 3, graph creation, which is kind of trivial, we want to go to the next level of, let me just go back to my slides. Okay, now let's look at the key point detector inside a graph. How would it look like, right? Your input is going to be an RGB image, and output is going to be key point arrays. So we got to create input as an image and output as a key point array, which I think the code already exists for that, so we don't need to do anything. And since you don't need access to the intermediate results, in this particular case is going to be the YUV image and grayscale image. We can just use VX create virtual image to create those objects. The only thing different between VX create image and virtual image is a create image takes context as a parameter. It resides within the context, whereas a virtual image stays within a graph, which is very local to the graph. You're telling to the graph saying this is what it appears as part of executing the graph, so you cannot access it from a context perspective. So you cannot also use a virtual image created in one graph in another graph. So that way you get a lot of optimizations because it is very local to the graph. Now you can insert color convert node, channel extract node, and Harris corner node into the graph. And we're going to look at some of those examples while actually doing it. I want to quickly go through the next slide, which kind of takes over the feature tracking graph. Right? Here, let's pretend we already been tracking before, or you know, we already ran the first frame using Harris. That way, we have the key points and the pyramid of a previous frame. Now, we're going to pass the input to the color convert. Let me just kind of skip this one because we went over this one already. So the two things that you need to look at here is we're going to need a delay object that has two elements, one for the current and one for the previous. And then similarly for the pyramids. And we're going to go over the details of the pyramid and delay object. I just use the PTS underscore delay to represent the key points and PYR delay to represent the pyramids in here. So let's go back to the exercise. I'm going to skip some of them really fast because there are a lot of slides that I want to go through in more detail. So here are the variables that you're kind of already familiar looking at the exercise one. You can kind of see all the Harris parameters starts with the keyword Harris underscore, and the naming is very kind of similar to the what we used in exercise one. And for pyramid, it starts for the tracking, it starts with LK. So for LK, you can specify the number of pyramid levels. In this particular case, kind of picked 6. And for the pyramid scale factor, kind of picked 6 levels, half the scale. And these are some of the parameters. We don't want to go too much detail. Let's use it for now. But if you look at the actual header file, at the specification, you'll find all the details about them. So let's jump into creating the next step, where we're going to create all the intermediate buffers. In this particular case, they're going to be the YUV image for Harris, YUV image for optical flow, and Luma grayscale image for Harris. And the optical flow. If you kind of see here, the virtual image takes graph as the first argument, and you have already created graph track. Now you can safely create intermediate buffers for Harris and optical flow using the same kind of parameters. So let's go to the source code. So I'm at to do step 4. I'm doing the old way. I think Carrie knows the hotkey for removing all the comments at once.
Control slash.
Okay, I'll do that. Okay, so pardon? You can't keep up with me? Is everybody on step 4? If you're not, let me know. So I can just hold on.
Could you go back to step 3? I want to double check.
Okay. Here.
So both of them are context.
So you're basically creating both the Harris graph and the tracking graph within the context. Right? Because you're going to be, both the graphs are going to use the image that is created within that context. And most of the examples we're going to be using, operating in one context. In fact, a lot of the applications will end up operating in one context unless there's a very specific need for that. The Harris YUV image is already created. Now the part we need to create is Luma, and it's going to have the same dimensions as the YUV. So I'm going to type width, comma, height. And the next part, the third part is what type the Luma is. We already did this for the first exercise. VXDF image underscore U8. And I'm going to copy the same for creating the optical flow for the tracking graph. Luma is like the grayscale, so it's like black and white. Yeah, luminance, basically. It's a shortcut, so sorry. I should have said grayscale. And make sure to specify graph track for the second two, because that's important. Otherwise, you'll end up getting a lot of errors when you actually try to run the graph. And I'm going to start creating the checking for the errors here. Copy paste, bunch of copy paste here. This is very similar to exercise one, except that we are just using virtual image and we have two graphs. So I ran it, I didn't see any errors in my code. Is anybody stuck with step four or three? We're not going to step two yet. We started with step three. We can go to step four. We'll come back to step one because I have to give you some concepts before we go in there. Sorry for that. I think the exercise, I'm going to reorganize it probably later. Okay, now that everybody's done, I'm going to switch back to the slides. By the way, Kiriti did get a copy of all the slides. They should be on your desk, so you can just flip through if you need help. You're going to need them for some parts of it. Especially where it comes handy is this slide, where you have to do a lot of typing. I may be switching to the QT, so you may not be able to see. So all here you're doing is very similar to what you did for the previous exercise one. You have to create all the scalar arguments for Harris as well as the optical flow. I would simply say just copy this code in the interest of time for now. There are three arguments for Harris. One is the strength threshold, mean distance, and sensitivity. And these thresholds can keep changing in live. For this particular example, we're going to keep them fixed, initialized, though it has the flexibility to take it as an input for every frame. And for optical flow, there are three parameters, epsilon, number of iterations, and use the initial estimate. For now, let's take these values as they are, just in the interest of time. Right? So I'm going to switch my window. Or I think I like that idea. So you guys can't blame me because Carrie gave the precedence here. I'm going to copy them from the solution. But they're kind of very easy to know. If you know the name of the scalar, the value is going to be Harris underscore that, except for the sensitivity parameter. And then the type is except for num iterations and use initial estimate. Everything else is a floating point parameter. Once I update this, I'm just going to run it to see if there's any compilation errors. No? Okay, cool. Any questions so far? That's the purpose of having a scalar, yes. So since it's a scalar object and you have an API to be able to change it, which is called, you know, read scalar value and write scalar value. So I think read scalar and write scalar function. So before you run the graph, you can just say, you know, write scalar. it'll just update it. And if you have some scalar as an output, for example, Harris at last parameter, which you used as null in the previous exercise, you can specify that. And that scalar, you can just read scalar after processing it. It'll get you the number of.
So the runtime tracks when in the in which sequence you call read and write, or write scalar and then process graph, that you could do write scalar, process graph, write scalar. You don't have to wait for the graph to be done processing.
Okay. So you're not supposed to modify any data when the graph kind of needs it, very similar to any other APIs that you use. For example, let's take an example here. Let's take strength threshold. And let's say you said, you asked it to run a graph. While it is running, you change the strength threshold. What strength threshold would a graph use will be unknown because you don't know at what instant it kind of it's going to use.
So process graph, is that an immediate call or is that a?
Yes, process graph is an immediate call. You call the process graph, it waits. There are two other functions. One is called schedule graph and wait graph, where schedule graph is supposed to return immediately, right? And then you can call wait graph to wait till the graph has executed.
So in that case, you're not supposed to write any scalars until you've waited for that graph.
Yes, so you want to make sure that dependencies are not overwritten there.
So you can't really set up multiple iterations of a graph in a pipeline.
Yes,
not you would have multiple copies of graphs, basically, if you would
create. You could have multiple graphs taking the same scalar value. That's perfectly okay, but if you wanna modify, give two different input, why do you wanna use one scalar? You would wanna use two different scalars because you're kind of changing in the middle.
So if I wanted the same graph in a pipeline, but with two scalar values.
So you want to stream, actually. So you want to start to execute the graph, and before it completes, you want to give the next.
But I already know what the next parameter is.
Yeah, so we don't have this prediction model today in OpenVX. This is something where we started to have some discussions. But today, the graph execution is synchronous or asynchronous, but asynchronous is just, okay, you execute your graph and you do something else on the CPU.
Yeah.
But you are not supposed to modify the graph.
Runtime is not keeping a mistake.
Yeah.
Today, the application may be able to achieve this by having multiple instances of the same, multiple graphs that are basically the same.
Yeah, if you want a three stage of pipeline, you get three graphs. And then you switch to the other one, etc. And you will benefit from parallelism anyway. Because you may have three graphs. But actually, OpenVX does not provide like a threat and tool in terms of standardization. So you need to look at the vendor, like at the implementation documentation, to check that you can do it. Actually, can you run? Can you call two different OpenVX call function call two different threads, for instance? This is up to the implementation today. So some may support it, some may tell you no. You should run all the OpenVX code in one single thread. So I don't know about But this is something that may change also. So if you have some ideas also, I think it's good to have this kind of feedback, like if you have some proposals, how to better support pipelining. Pipelining is good for some people, and for some other it may not be good. So if you believe it's good for your architecture, for your targets, I think it's good to give this feedback in the forum or even to contribute
the standardization group. Yep. So you saw that link on Neil's slide. You just go to Khronos OpenVX and you'll see a forum tab. Just post your question there. Any other questions?
Can we be able to change this, for example, sensitivity during the looping of the image?
Yes, you should be able to change it, yeah. Just make sure you change it before you launch the graph. Or you schedule the graph, or you process the graph.
But let's say I got only 10 points. I want to drop the sensitivity, so I want to get more than 10.
Yes, yeah. That's the purpose. That's the reason this is a scalar. So we're going to look at the actual kernel declaration. If you actually look at the Harris, for example, if you look at the declaration, some of them are scalar, which expects floating point, and some of them are like integers. For example, if it's a your gradient size, Sobel operator size, it is 3 or 5 or 7, whatever it is, it wants to take that as an integer, not as a scalar, because you don't want to change that during the execution. But that's how you know which parameters are changeable, which parameters are not changeable. If it is scalar, by definition, that means the implementation should support changing of it.
Let's maybe use a scalar object, because like an integer is a scalar in the C language.
Oh, okay. So there is a scalar object, right.
This is a scalar OpenVX object, so it's a different. And actually, when you have such an object as input, you could also insert a node that is going to compute inside the graph which value for the sensitivity you want. So we are going to discuss about the user nodes at the end of the afternoon if we have time.
Yeah.
So and you may be able to create your own node that is going to generate this sensitivity.
Okay, we already passed 30 minutes, so I want to kind of move forward quickly. Now, pyramid object represents collection of related images. We talked about this one. Now, images are created by either by downscaling or upscaling, but in the standard, we're only going to use it only sub kind of the primitives that exist only support the downscaling, especially by a factor of half and R, which is like fourth root of half. There are a few restrictions, including on supported image formats. In this particular case, we only support 8-bit images for now. A vendor can extend whichever way they need to. The call is VX create pyramid. You specify the context and specify number of levels, width and height. And the level zero is going to be the base. Level zero is going to be the same image as what the input is going to be. So that way, there is no scale factor involved. It's just kind of a representation. And if you need to create a virtual pyramid, which is very local to the graph, you could create saying VX create virtual pyramid. That's a call in there. And exercise 2 has some constant that you can use for creating this pyramid. I think we talked about earlier. Now you have LK pyramid levels and LK pyramid scale, which is initialized to half. Okay. Any questions on pyramids?
Great.
Any restrictions about being factor of 2 or alignment or anything like that?
For the scale factor?
Well, no, for the pyramids in general. Can be any size?
Okay, the question is there any restrictions on factor of 2? No, the pyramid size dimensions doesn't have to be factor of 2. So it can be any size. The way it computes the size is that the equation is actually specified in the specification. Okay, it is basically the ceiling of, you take the width and height, and then you multiply that by the scale factor, and then you seal that kind of round up. That gets you the
width and
height. It's a Gaussian theorem.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, all the parameters are rotated. How do you
I'm going to talk about that in the next one. Yes. Yep. This just defines the data structure. It doesn't tell you how it's computed. Okay.
Why does it need to look and hide if later you're going to call, like, some kind of, you're going to create a node, which I'm assuming is going to have the event as an input, right? So, but the image knows what the height is. So, why do you need
this here
as well?
Okay, so you can create a pyramid. Let's say you create a pyramid and you want to reuse it again for something else. Then, in which case, you're going to need to know. Buffer has already been previously allocated. You want to reuse that one. In which case,
if
okay, so it's so that the runtime can pre-allocate.
Yeah, it's up to the implementation, yeah. If it is virtual, I agree, you don't need to specify. When it's a virtual buffer, you don't have to specify width, height, even format. The framework has a mechanism to know that. I think in the user kernel node, it gets more clear how the underlying framework handles that. The next thing is let's look at a delay object, which is a ring buffer of objects maintained by the system. It can take any kinds of OpenVX data objects with few restrictions. Well, one restriction is it supports, you can have a delay of image or pyramid or array or scalar, matrix distribution, remap. a bunch of other ones, but you cannot have a delay of a delay. That is not allowed in there. That's one of the restrictions. And the way you pass, you create a delay object is by passing a desired object's exemplar, the word you use the exemplar here, and you pass that as a reference. So let's say if you want to create a delay of pyramids, what you do is you create a pyramid, and then you pass it as a reference. So reference, I think Kari has explained to you that during the first session, any object can be casted to VX reference and then passed to the lower framework. And then you specify number of counts. I have an example here that makes it more clear. So let's say we created a pyramid exemplar. Just use a regular VX pyramid. And then you call VX create delay. And then you pass the actual exemplar and say how many delay slots are there. In this particular case, we only need current and previous, so two are good enough. Right? And what the create delay does is it doesn't actually use any of the data from it other than the metadata, means just looking at the width and height and number of levels and scale factors, whatever defines the pyramid, not actual physical data. So that's why you kind of call it exemplar. And once you create the delay object, now that exemplar is not needed anymore, so it's better always to release an exemplar immediately after because you don't need the handle of that. And now what next? Once you have a delay object, now you want to be able to access an object that's at index 0 or t minus 1. Kind of, it's important to note that here the indices are not positive since it's a delay element. In signal processing, you kind of use 0, minus 1, minus 2. So in this particular case, you get a reference from delay of pyramid, and it returns a VX reference object. Now you have to cast it back to pyramid. Given that you already know it's a pyramid, it is safe to cast it back to pyramid. One natural question comes down is, what if I cast it to array? You would hit error somewhere else during the runtime when you try to use it. Right? And for pyramid 1, at delay slot minus 1, you specify minus 1 here.
When you create the delay, you only created one. I don't quite understand how you can access two delays if you only created one object.
Count.
Is there two?
Count of two. It's the final parameter.
Second array.
It's a ring buffer. You're saying how many buffers are there inside, how many objects are there in the delay object. In this particular case, there are two. So you can kind of say one at index 0, and one at index minus 1.
You only got the exemplar as one instance of the pyramid. So you put the same reference in both delay slots?
Okay, I got that.
Okay. When you pass an exemplar here, what the VX create delay does is it uses the pyramid only to get to know what are the parameters of the pyramid, such as width, height, scale factor, number of levels. It doesn't use the data. It just picks up that data and it creates its own pyramid objects. The pyramid objects that get created are completely new ones. They are not connected to the original pyramid. Only thing it uses is just the data, metadata out of it. It's just to make the API cleaner. Otherwise, we have to have create pyramid delay, create image delay. That's too many functions to do that. So in addition to accessing the delay, there is one more function called age delay. All it does is when once you make a call, for example, in this particular case, you're asking the ring buffer to kind of circle around. So now 0 becomes minus 1, minus 1 previously becomes minus 2, and the last one, which is not used, will become 0. That way, kind of cycling through the buffers. So if you have two, it's just swapping these two. Any more questions? Okay, I have to run really fast here. So let's go back to the exercise. We're going to the Now we're going to step one, where we're going to create the pyramids and the delay objects. I think initially when I created it, I just kept them on the top because thinking it doesn't need any graph object as a parameter, but when I go through the slides, I figured it out. Maybe I should move them reverse way. So for creating a pyramid exemplar, I'm going to uncomment all this code. Control slash. Thanks, Curry. So first one, pyramid exemplar, the code is already given to you. There's nothing you need to do. And pyramid delay, as you have seen in the example, it's straightforward to create. And once you create, you can just release the exemplar permit. Now, the point you need to do is for creating the array exemplar and array delay point, right? So we're going to create array in the context, and this is going to be key point. So we're going to type vx underscore type underscore key point. That's the type of the key point array. And then what's the capacity? So we have an enum called max key point count defined, or you can just pass 10,000, whatever the value. If we want that value to be kind of 10,000. And once you create the exemplar for the key point array, now you want to create the delay object. Now, delay object sits within the context. So the first parameter is going to be context. And then we have to pass the exemplar, in which case, which is key point exemplar. And then we need number of delay slots, which is going to be 2. So if you notice, it should give us a compilation error. Well, it's going to take a while, so I'm going to fix it anyway. So you cast it to VX reference, because the delay takes the argument as VX reference here. And similar to the other one, as soon as you create the exemplar, as soon as you create the delay, you don't need the exemplar anymore. You can release it. And then you want to make sure you check the error, whether the delay element creation is successful or failure.
The delay, your depiction of the delay is not in line with a ring buffer. So is it? It's not really a ring buffer, right? I mean, that's not what a delay is. But
yes. It's not defined as a ring buffer. I'm kind of giving that as an implementation from an implementation perspective. You consider that as a ring buffer.
Well, it's
no. What it's the spec tells is that it's going to shift, but it doesn't tell you what slot zero will contain.
Well, it'd be the previous one. If you called age delay 10 times, and if you don't put a new input in.
Yeah,
you just get the same one 9 times.
You will have garbage potentially. So
yeah.
Well, no, you'll have the previous one.
But I mean,
yeah, well,
I don't think it's.
That is true. Yes.
No. I don't think it's defined as a ring buffer in the spec. So this is a way most of people implement it. But the spec doesn't tell you that it's going to circulate like this. So you edge, and if you edge 10 times, you should consider that you have garbage.
There's no, like, when you age it, what's in index 0 is undefined.
Yeah.
So you have to not, the oldest one will not pop in there, or the newest one is not copied there.
Okay.
It's undefined.
Yeah.
So like, implementation might leave the old one there, but that's undefined.
Yeah, the implementation can extend it. OpenVX and decide, okay, I'm going to actually, this guy is going to go there when I age. But it's not like a
specification on whether you can call new input before you call age. Because otherwise, you're not disqualifying, you don't have any synchronization. I mean, there's,
it's not
really a ring buffer.
I mean, it's not really ring buffer because ring buffer would shift the oldest one to index 0.
Right.
I mean, that's the difference. It's like logical shift to right rather than like arithmetic shift to right. So it's not defined what happens to the one that becomes empty.
So usually you shift, you age, and you need to put the data, the new data, the current data into the slot.
Yeah.
It's undefined. If you don't do that, it's undefined.
Start. Yes.
Okay.
By the spec. All
right.
But usually you do it for like video processing, so usually you don't care about losing this one.
It's not clearly, it's not explicitly specified. It doesn't say you get garbage either. So.
Actually, you might care. I mean. If you just want to update every 10th image, you just put a delay in there of every 10th image.
Well, I think if you have a use case, I think it's interesting for us to know the use case, right, because then we can. It's a use case driven also the way we standardize. Also, we don't standardize the feature that are useful for for use case. So if you please give us this feedback. I think it's useful.
All right.
Okay. Any other questions on the pyramids and delays? And so now let's go to the step two, where now that we created the pyramid delay objects, now we need to kind of access.
Why are you releasing the pyramid as a key point?
Oh, sorry,
I have to
say.
Could you use the delay
instead?
Pyramid stake sampler. You only need it temporarily to tell what kind of things
you're doing.
That's an array.
The
key point is an array.
This one?
Yeah, you're releasing a pyramid. Yeah.
You're right. That was a typo. I should have compiled it. I didn't compile it. Yeah, I should get a compile time error. You're right.
Just a quick
thanks
comment.
For catching that.
Just a quick comment. Just to have a general review.
You have to take it.
Why not just create a release that understands the object it's releasing as opposed to have a release?
We have that. If you look at the OpenVX 1.1,
we have a retain.
Okay. To increment the reference count, and we have a general case to decrement the reference count.
Sorry, about 3 times slower. Oh.
Okay, I got a feedback. I should go slower. Please stop me if I'm going faster. Please don't hesitate to stop me. Yeah, okay. I think it's important to go over this one because the concepts here are going to be needed for when you do the next level. So I'm going to move to the step two if there are no questions. Sure. Yep. So all you're doing is you're creating an exemplar for a pyramid or an array, and then using that exemplar to create a delay of 2 slots. And then you're making sure the delay slot is created by just checking that. And then once you've done that, you're just releasing the exemplar because you don't need the exemplar anymore. Yes, it is just used to create that. That doesn't mean you cannot use, your application might use, but in this particular case, we don't need it. That's why we're not going to do that. So we got 10 more minutes. Sorry for rushing. So the next part is once you have the delay element, you want to be able to access the current item and the previous item. Means one object, for example, the pyramid object for the current and the pyramid object for the previous frame. Similarly for key point array also. So the way you do that is get reference from delay. And what get reference from delay takes is first argument is going to be the delay object. So I'm going to uncomment this. And for the current pyramid, the code is already given. It takes the pyramid delay. For the previous pyramid, you're going to pass the same as before in terms of the object. You're going to type pyramid delay. And the index, you should type it as -1. Right? And very similarly for the key points, get reference from the key point. We just type key point delay. And the index is going to be 0. And key points. You're right. Thanks. And then after you do that, you should always cast it back to the, if it's an array key point, make sure to cast it back to the array. That way you get compilation errors. I built it, and there are no compilation errors in my code so far. Any questions?
How do you prime the delay?
What?
How do you prime the delay?
Prime?
Yeah, I mean, at this point, it's garbage.
Okay, the data inside that is, it has created, for let's take the pyramid delay. It has created two pyramid objects, and it kept it inside the delay at index 0 and index minus 1. They are uninitialized at this stage. That means there could be garbage. Right? It's your responsibility to make sure, just like malloc, you got a pointer, you got a buffer, you just have to take care of initializing that.
But for the moment, we just build the graph, right?
Yeah, we're not there yet, but I think that's a goal. First, we just want to create the objects so that we have the objects, and the next part is going to be building a graph that initializes them. And we went through step 3, 4, 5 already, so I'm going to switch to the presentation. Pardon? I'm going to check to make sure all the objects created. There is no error with it. So let me try to create an error here artificially. Let's say I try to access key points delay at an index minus 2. Let's see what happens. Okay. I try to run the code. Yes, I did get an error at line number 209, which is here. Right? That's because I accessed an index minus 2, whereas my delay only has 2 delay slots. So it can only go from 0 to minus 1. It's always good to create these error checks. That way you kind of catch the errors really quick. Done? OK. I'm going to switch to the slides now. Let's see how far we got. We're done with the delay object. Accessing the delay objects. Now, let's look at the exercise 2. What are we going to do? I think we kind of went over most of it already. We created the graphs, data objects. We created the graphs within the context. And we just need to now build the graphs, actually populate the graphs with all the kernels and nodes that we want, and then verify the graphs. Once we do that, and we just have to make sure for every frame, we kind of pass the input reading. And this part is already there, so we don't have to do anything. Just need to do the part where we process the Harris, our tracking. We want to run the Harris graph if it is the 0th frame. Otherwise, we're going to run the tracking. That way, it kind of keeps continuously. And then after that, displaying result, and then aging the delay objects. Right? Let's see. Harris for frame 0. So we went through this again. I want to kind of go through it once again. So we're going to take an input frame, do the color convert node, right, which produces a IYUV object, IYUV buffer that we previously created, which is a virtual image. And then we're going to pass that virtual image to channel extract to get the grayscale image, which also we created. Once we get the grayscale image, we want to run the Gaussian pyramid. It's a kernel. I think that goes to your question. There's a kernel for Gaussian, which basically does half the scaling, and then a 3x3 Gaussian filter it applies.
That's like default.
That's like default. Yeah, that's one you have. Well, there are other. You can kind of have more kernels. If you have a particular custom one, you can build it. I think we're going to have some other kernels that will be coming later, which uses pyramids to do that in 1.1. And that pyramid creation is so that we are initializing the pyramid at index 0, because that is needed when we delay. When you process the frame 1, you're going to need the pyramid of the frame 0 available. When you're tracking, when you actually want to track the features on frame 1, it needs a pyramid of frame 1 and a pyramid of frame 0. So what we're doing here is we are computing the pyramid and then keeping it as keeping it in delay slot 0 of the pyramid, and then we're going to compute the Harris kernels directly from the grayscale image, keeping it, keep it inside the slot zero of the key point error delay. Right? Once you do that, and then what we want to do is we want to age the delay. That way, the zero index will go back to minus one before processing the next frame.
Well, actually, here you could write directly to minus one.
I agree, but I'll tell you why not.
Then you don't need to age.
I'll tell you why not. It makes the code much simpler. So we need to create both Harris and tracking graphs. We'll go over the rest of them. So let's jump to step six.
Another question?
Yes.
I'm just wondering, for the steps that you're not planning to repeat, if it's worth to even create a graph, why can't you just do it in this immediate mode?
You could do that in the immediate mode. The reason for putting that graph is, if you want to, after this session, if you want to go back and let's say you want to run Harris after every 10th frame, or some, you have some criteria that you want to use, because the problem with key points is, let's say people are coming into the scene and going away from the scene. After some time, what happens is all the key points will be lost. You'll be left with nothing to track. So there's a criteria that you're going to use. You could use some other criteria. As part of exercise three, actually exercise four, we're not going to cover now. You can define a user node to do that.
No, I understand that. I guess my question is if there will be any performance differences between, you know, doing things in the immediate mode or, you know,
yes, there will be.
There will be. I'll cover that as part of last slide. I'll explain you that. Actually, now that you asked the question of will there be any difference, let me cover that one. Since we have only 3 minutes, I won't be able to do the exercise in that time. So let's go look at... Yeah, let's look here. Okay, so if you specify the Harris part as a graph, let's look at the first one we have is a color convert node, and then the intermediate buffer is a virtual image where you're telling the framework that you're not interested to read or write from that buffer. So it's up to the framework to do whatever it wants to do. And similarly, the Luma one also. Now, framework can look at it and say, it can look at the whole graph and say the chroma parts are not useful. So it can directly fuse these two and say, I just need from RGB to gray. And if I have my own internal implementation, I can just fuse these two and then say, I can directly go from color convert to color convert producing directly the grayscale image. Now, it doesn't have to end there. It can look at the Harris also. If you look at Harris, the first part of it is gradient computation. When you look at gradient computation, you have to kind of pull the data. You're doing a 3x3 gradient, in which case you could, an implementation could do a tiling. It can just say, I'm going to take the RGB in a 256x256, compute the grayscale, and then immediately do the gradient operation. It might be able to fuse all these three at once. Right? And a lot of optimizations like that are possible by specifying as a graph, which is not possible. If you say immediate mode, you're saying this cannot be a virtual. That means as soon as the call ends in color convert, if somebody tries to access that buffer, it has to have IYUV data, in which case there's nothing underlying implementation can do to optimize it. All it can do is make sure that the color convert to IYUV runs fastest. That's all they can do. So we looked at Harris graph. Now let's try to build a Harris graph. And for that, we need to go to step six in the source code. So there's a lot of text in there in the comments, but I think if you just look at the code that is in the comments instead of the text, I think that gives you enough information and your prior knowledge of what Harris corner is in terms of VX you call. The parameters are going to be very similar here. Instead of passing a context for VXU, for a graph node, you just pass it as a, you pass the Harris, the graph object. That's the only difference, okay? And VXU function, since it tries to execute something immediately, it returns a status saying success or failure. In a case of a creating a graph node object, it just returns a node object that you can further use later if you want to set it to attributes and a couple of other APIs that you have. We're not going to cover that in this spec, in this part of the exercise. So let's get started on this one. I'm going to switch to the Qt Curator. Let me just go there. So this is step 06. Let me scroll down. Sorry for this. So let me explain you a few things before I go further into the actual API, the kind of the code, the way I organize the code here. Given that VX color convert node and these kind of APIs return node objects, and I have to create, for each of the call, I have to create a separate object separately. So I kind of created an array of nodes. I'm just kind of filling in these function calls in there. So in this particular case, you can see the VX nodes Harris. This statement takes care of calling VX color convert node, channel extract node, Gaussian pyramid node, Harris corners node, and then put the values written by them in the array there. So that way it kind of, it's easy for me to type in, and also the code looks smaller for me to explain it on the slides here. And then in one for loop, I kind of go through each one of those objects and then look to see, is it valid? If it is valid, I don't need those objects anymore because I already created that node. It is part of the graph. It's part of this exercise. We're not going to do any attribute setting or querying that node. So I don't need that object anymore, so I'm releasing it. Releasing just means that you're just giving up your reference. There is still a reference that sits with the graph because you created the node from the context of the graph. Right, so graph already has a reference, so the object doesn't disappear just because you released. It goes back to what Kari has mentioned about reference counts. Right? And then once you kind of check the errors and release the nodes, and the next one is, we'll come back to here later. So let's go back to the color, the creating the nodes here. So the first one is color convert node. This is very similar to what you did in the exercise one. Instead of context, instead of VXU, we're using VX color convert node. Graph, instead of context, we're specifying the graph context because we want this node to be created as part of graph, a Harris graph. Input RGB image, which is the input which comes at, which is there on the top of the main. We didn't go through it. I think you went through it as part of the exercise one. And you have already created a YUV image, which is a virtual image. So we call it Harris underscore YUV underscore image. I can probably go there by pressing F2. Yep, you remember this code where we did a YUV image creation grayscale for Harris, and we created similar ones for optical flow. So we're going to use the Harris YUV and Luma images here. Page down. So that's what we pass here for the YU image. Now, next one is channel extract. Channel extract is very similar to before. So we have the Harris, and then we specify it. You already have the enum here for channel Y, and output is going to be the Luma, which is a grayscale. So there's one more parameter it takes here, which is going to be YU image. Thank you. I'm trying to copy Kari here. Harris YUV image, perfect. And then Gaussian pyramid, same. Gaussian pyramid basically, let's look at the description of Gaussian pyramid because we haven't looked at this before. Oh boy. Yeah. So here it takes input is an image.
Control shift.
but you could do it as a virtual machine learner. You could do it as a virtual machine learner.
Yeah, okay. This is easy. This is easy for now. Right? So here, we're creating Gaussian pyramid node, which takes input image. And this image has to be a grayscale image, which is the Luma, Harris Luma by UV. And the output is a Gaussian pyramid. And it expects that input to be U8 and output to be U8. It kind of specifies explicitly. An implementation can extend it. It's up to the implementation there. It kind of clearly specifies what it's kind of performing here. And I'm going to switch back. The implementation here. Yeah. So we have to pass the input image here. So this is going to be Harris Luma image. OK. That's great. Now comes to looking at the Harris Khronos node. This is going to take a lot of parameters that are very similar to what we did in exercise one. We can go ahead and look at the actual regression. You see it takes the input image, strength threshold, mean distance, sensitivity, gradient size, block, number of Khronos, which is very similar to what you did. Right? So I'll try to type it directly in there because I know what those are. If you're not exactly sure, you can go back to exercise one. You can copy paste it here. Most of those parameters uses the same names. So, okay, let me start that. Graph Harris, first one is an image, which is going to be Harris Luma image. And the second one, you can see it says strength threshold. You can kind of see it got bolded here. So luckily, I use the same name, strength threshold. And the next one is mean distance. Mean distance. After that, it takes sensitivity. Then there is gradient size. I think we call it Harris gradient size. Followed by Harris block size. And then array Khronos, which is already kept in there. So let me try to kind of format it so that you can kind of read the text that I typed here. So the parameters that you need to type are these that I kind of highlighted here, Harris Luma image. So all the scalars will have the same name as the parameters of the node. And if it is not a scalar like integer, like gradient size, they have Harris underscore before that. Any questions so far?
So what exactly is the code doing?
This line? OK. So what this line basically is doing is it is calling VX Harris Khronos node function. Okay, whatever gets returned will be saved as nodes Harris 0, 1, 2, 3, as the third element of that array will be stored. So this is very similar to.
So it creates a node in the graph. So you have a Harris node. And it's going to be connected by the data flow. So each node reads and writes. It has some inputs and some outputs that you specify as parameters. And then the edges are going to be created automatically for you. So you create the nodes with the inputs and outputs, and then automatically you have your graphs. So you don't need much more code compared to the immediate mode, actually. You need to create a graph, and for each function that you have in the immediate mode, you need to create a node.
And it goes too far.
And then you verify, and that's it. You have your graph.
So we're trying to
not have been ordered. Those don't have been any
graph.
The order is not important.
So all we're trying to do is create the color convert node within the graph, channel extract node in the graph, Gaussian pyramid node in the graph, and then Harris corner node in the graph.
And we're turning that to a node.
Yes, yeah. Creating.
No, that holding it
into an array of nodes. It's an array of nodes, so it's kind of a little confusing the way I put it, but it's an array of nodes. I'm just interested.
Yeah. Actually, other you could simplify. You could just remove this array of nodes. You just call the node function, and you don't even need to release the reference, because when the graph will be destroyed, automatically the node will be destroyed.
It's a kind of useful programming paradigm, so I left it like that, but I could simplify it if it's confusing people.
Some of these things are EX scalars, like the
yeah,
strength threshold is created into like grid science is going to EX scalar, but things like
the data frames,
progression gradient size,
and then the dependency, like the dependency. So you know that if one node reads another one, it should be executed after. So you have this kind of.
So the question is. Why is that certain things such as threshold and mean distance sensitivity are scalar objects, whereas the gradient size and block size are not? The reason for that is typically in most use cases for the Harris, you will not change the gradient size and block size for a given configuration. You kind of pick it and stay constant. And also it has an implication of performance underneath, whether you're using a 3x3 window or a 5x5 window. It has a different implication of how you kind of schedule the stuff, and how do you decide your tiling size and a bunch of other internal parameters. So those were left intentionally as saying these are fixed. Once you create a node, they cannot be changed. Whereas things like sensitivity and mean distance and strength threshold, you might choose depending on the context, but that's just a threshold value. That's the reason. Okay, if everybody's done creating the node, the next thing to look at is, okay, we don't need these intermediate buffers, Harris, YUV, and Luma image. We can just release them. And now, at this stage, before, till the line 333, you have really constructed the graph. You put all the nodes in there. You created a graph. You instantiated all the nodes inside the graph. You connected the inputs to the outputs. Right? Now, there's a well-defined data path going from input to the output.
Release the intermediate nodes, so internally the graph does not need these intermediate nodes?
Okay. When you release a intermediate node here, you're just saying that you don't need, as an application, you don't need that reference anymore, so the reference count gets decremented. Given that there is one, two references, that two nodes have references to it, and those nodes have references inside a graph, so graph already keeps track of this. Okay, there are some references. It doesn't physically get removed, but it's just that you're giving up your reference.
It's not going to be destroyed.
Yes.
We because have the graph has a reference.
We have built the graph up to here. Yep. Components of the, well.
I don't know what that's meant.
Okay.
Well, we haven't built the graph. We just have the nodes and put it all together.
So when you specify a node here, when you say VX color convert node, and we specify a graph, you're asking it to instantiate a kernel. Instance of a kernel is called a node. Inside the graph, you're putting a node. So you're already putting a node. In addition, it returns the node object, so you can use for additional APIs, such as additional APIs that we're not going to cover in this tutorial, such as setting certain border modes, certain attributes that you could choose.
You may want to keep the reference to the node if the node is at the beginning of the graph, because the next time you want to execute, maybe you want to change the input. You want to change the parameters because you have new data.
So literally, when the graph, once you're done building a graph, what you need to do is call verify graph. So this is where you're telling the underlying framework to see if there are any inconsistencies, such as if you have loops in the graph, OpenVX expects the graph to be kind of acyclic, means you cannot have cycles in there. and you cannot have certain parameters not defined. So it kind of checks, looks for all the consistencies, and also it might look for certain data types, saying if you, by mistake, if you pass a RGB image to a, let's say, Gaussian pyramid, all those errors will be checked during this time. In addition to that, this is also gives an opportunity for implementation to go optimize it. It can now look at the underlying context where it is created, all the parameters that if you have set any specific hardware optimization parameters, it can try to optimize that stuff in terms of fusing kernels and all that. Right? So for verify graph, all you pass is simply the name of the graph, which is the graph object. In this particular case, that's going to be graph Harris. So once you're done, now we got a graph that is built and verified. That means it is ready to run. Only thing you need to do is set the inputs and then run the graph, look at the outputs. So I'm just running to see there is no error. So there are no compilation errors here. And the next part is going to be very similar. But here, we'll be building a graph for optical flow. Right. So let me switch to the presentation. Sorry, this looks ugly because okay. So when it comes to the optical flow graph, we have same color convert, very similar one, right? Same color convert, which takes the same input. And it has its own intermediate YUV and grayscale buffers, which is that are local to the graph. And then Gaussian pyramid, very similar. It generates into the pyramid zero. Now the interesting part, this is the part that is completely different, which is optical flow, which looks at the pyramid from index 0 and index minus 1, and the points from it reads the key point array that corresponds to the previous frame. Right? It kind of takes those three as input, and then it outputs, it kind of finds out where the points have moved. And then you want to keep it back at point 0. Key point, basically, the delay element 0th index. That's where you want to keep it. Okay. Any questions on the high level graph question in terms of why it is like this?
Just a quick question. So you can easily share the object between the graphs with no additional function calls?
Yeah. So as long as the objects are not virtual objects, which are local to the graph, if the objects are within the context, yes, you can share. Yeah. You can take the output of a graph, give it as an input to another graph, but you have to make sure you're scheduling it in the order. So there's, you're not running two graphs, one takes input and output simultaneously. I'm kind of switching to the notation. Okay, so here is, it's the same one. So I'm gonna fill in the first two. Third one is where we need to think some more. So channel extract node, and first part is we wanna make sure we're passing graph track, because the tracking graph is what we're building here. Channel extract node. Does anybody remember what's the first argument it's going to be?
YUV image.
So let's say that's going to be optical flow YUV image, because we can't use the Harris one. If you try using Harris, you will get an error. Then we need to specify channel. Very similar to before, channel Y, and then optical flow Luma image. That takes care of building the channel extract node. And for Gaussian, it is very similar to before, but we're going to use optical flow Luma image. Now let's look at the optical flow pyramid node. So I'm going to push F2 here, and F2 again, so it goes to the header file. And if you see the first one it takes is an old pyramid. Maybe I should zoom some more so you can see it. Yeah. first parameter is the old pyramid, which is going to be the pyramid at the index minus 1 from the delay. And the second one is going to be the pyramid at index 0. And then new point estimates. Now, optical flow takes a means to where you can specify some estimates. If you have an alternate mechanism to specify an estimate, you can pre-compute it and give that as an estimate to further ask the Lucas Carnot to further refine it. Or you can pass your previous points as your best estimates, because at this moment, that's the best estimate that we have, right? You can pass the previous key points, which is from the key point delay slot from index minus 1. And new points, these are the key points that are kind of output, which is the output from the optical flow. And these are a bunch of parameters that we define within the scope and scalars. I think this is like termination. We already initialized it to do both. And epsilon, we have a scalar, num iterations, use initialize. This use initialize flag basically says whether to use this pointer, this object or not. If you don't specify it, it kind of uses the previous one, old points in there. And window dimension is kind of fixed in our example. Right? Any questions? You'll find all the details in the spec, so I'm going to skip that one in the interest of time. So I'm going to go here, verify graph. So we have old image is going to be the previous pyramid. Remember, we extracted previous pyramid and current pyramid in like step two, I guess. Step two, we did that. And current pyramid that we just computed using the Gaussian pyramid here, just above here, we computed the current pyramid. And for the old points, we're going to use previous key points. And for estimates also, we're going to use previous key points as our estimates now. And then we're going to use the current key points, which is going to be the output. And then we have termination. We have a scalar called, let me see, maybe it's called. I think it's called LK underscore termination. Yep, it's LK underscore termination because it takes it as a enumeration there. And then we have epsilon, E-P-S-I-L-O-N. Epsilon is a scalar. I think we called it LK underscore epsilon. And LK underscore num iterations, which is same as the scalar that we created. And then use initial estimates. I think you have a previous key point twice. Yes, one is an estimate, good point. And then window dimension is LK window dimension. Let me try to format this so that it's readable. That's it. So we pass the graph, the previous pyramid, and the current pyramid. And previous key points, we pass it twice because one is to say the previous key points, the other one is an estimate to say what is our best estimate. If we could use estimate, we're just passing the previous one as the estimates. And output is current key points, and then we're passing a bunch of scalars and constant values to configure the notation. Pardon?
Epsilon should not be scalar.
Epsilon should not be scalar? Or should be scalar, you're right. So that's the way. Oh, great. Thank you. Number of iterations, use initial. Number of iterations should be scalar.
Use initial as well.
That should be scalar. Great. Let me just compile to make sure I didn't. Oh, looks like I did make some error here.
Every termination is not defined.
LK termination is not defined. It should be defined. Yeah, verify graph is not defined, yes. Verify graph, I think now that we constructed the graph, we can simply specify graph track. I just made sure there are no compilation errors so far. So far what we got, I think we came to the extent of building both the graphs. I think the next thing to look at is being able to execute these graphs, giving the input and executing the graphs. We'll go over that. And then also after running the graph, we want to take the results and display it. Right? We'll go over that code. Now that it's 1:30, I think we have to shift to our original agenda afternoon because we have speakers waiting here. I want to take at least give a chance for people to ask last few questions. Does anybody have any questions on this, being able to run the graph? Build the optical flow graph.
Where do you do the delay or where you shift the buffer, right?
We're going to come to that in the next part of the thing. So after you execute once, that's when you want to say, okay, I want to kind of age each delay. So kind of the current one becomes the previous one. The index 0 becomes index minus 1. I'm going to talk to that after this one.
Is there something just make the delay a different node in the graph. In the whole DAG, the delay would just be another node.
Is the goal to have it automatically edged?
No, it would take the graph to take care of itself. That node, all its purpose is to delay that signal.
It has certain problems because your question is about why can't delay aging become a node?
Yeah, it would be just a node in the graph.
Then what happens is now you're forcing that. I cannot have an application where I run a bunch of graphs,
right,
and then I want to age it once, and then run again a bunch of graphs. So I may not want to.
You can't do that either, because you've got references to those nodes that are in the age.
Yes,
so you can't do that anyway.
So there is a feature that I haven't explained to you that yet. So in the node, when you age it, the graph will automatically switch the pointers. When you age a delay, when you move the pointers, graph will automatically switch the pointers internally.
Well, that's what I'm saying, that's what the node would actually do when it executes.
Yeah.
When it executes.
One of the other problems is you don't necessarily know that every node executes sequentially. Right, so that becomes a problem. Like you don't know that that's the order things going. If you're doing tile-based operation or something, at what point do you get there?
So we have done to the extent of building both the graphs. Now the next part is being able to actually, now that we kind of built all the Harris graph and the optical flow graph, now the job is the main loop where we kind of execute, get the input from the OpenVX, from the OpenCV buffer, and then we copy it into the OpenVX image, and then launch the graph, and then look at the outputs, and then display the results onto the screen. That's a small part left. I'm hoping we should be able to cover that really quick. So I will try to move directly to the example code. Let's see. Okay, one question. Did everybody, is everybody able to do to the extent of verifying the graph, both the graphs, or is anybody stuck before that? Okay, great. So let me give you an overview of the main loop of the code. This is going to be very similar to what we did in the exercise one. And we have a frame index going from 0 to as many number of frames that are available in the video sequence that we picked. GIA is just an abstraction, so let's not go into the detail. And then the first part we do is we grab the buffer from the OpenCV, which takes the BGR buffer, converts it into RGB. That way we have it perfectly formatted. And then we're going to copy that into the input RGB image using access image patch and commit image patch. If you were to use 1.1, you would use VX copy image patch. That way it's just one function call and it's pretty easy in there. And if there are other use cases where you could use image create from handle, in which case you can make the OpenCV buffer used as internal to the OpenVX. You can kind of wrap up a buffer. You can kind of do an interop between OpenCV and OpenVX. Thierry is going to cover the details of that. So for now, let's assume the code is going to be, we're going to, in this particular example, use the same one that we used in exercise one. Right? So once the input buffer is copied, and after the commit, now input RGB image is now, the data of it is owned by the framework. Kind of we gave the control back to the framework. Right? So what's the first thing to do? We got all the graphs readily available at this plane. All we need to do is launch the graph. So what we want to do for the first frame, we want to launch the Harris graph. For rest of the frames, we want to launch tracking graph, right? So all you do is you look at the index, frame index. You look to see if the frame index is equal to 0, you simply call VX process graph, graph Harris. Otherwise, you simply call VX process graph, graph track. That's all we do here. And then we check to make sure if the error status is a failure. Are you able to run it or not? So let's do that. So the command we're going to use is VX process graph. And if you see, which kind of takes the graph as the parameter. There are two ways of scheduling, running a graph. One is using VX process graph, and there is another set of pair called schedule graph and wait graph. Okay, pretty much process graph call is same as calling schedule graph immediately followed by a wait graph. So you can kind of, if you want to do a functionality where you want to schedule something, let it go off, get it scheduled on the hardware, let it process. Meanwhile, you want to do some other computation or some other work that you want to do. That's when you use schedule and wait. For this example, let's constrain to VX process graph. So what I'm going to do?
Suggestion, right?
Yes.
Since you don't have time, why don't you go to the solution one and start explaining from there? Will that be faster and efficient?
Well, if I pick the launch graph and schedule graph, it'll be much longer than me doing it here.
No, I'm saying other than typing everything here.
Okay. You want me to explain that? Is that okay with everybody? Okay, let's do that. So if you go to the solution, I'm going to keep it here. Yeah, here. You can kind of see if frame index equal to 0, I just pick the graph Harris. Otherwise, pick the graph track. You're just basically launching it, and you're checking the return status of VX process graph. That should pretty much launch the graph there. And now, once the control comes out of the process graph, now we know that the output key points should be valid. right? So for the first frame, no, okay, this is important to understand. For the first frame, the key point delay element, index 0, will have a value that is valid, means it might have, let's say, 500 key points. But the delay element 0 is not outputted anything. That means it will have no data points in it. So it should have, ideally, 0 key points in there. By default, the array you did not initialize, so it has 0 key points in there. So what we want to do is we want to look to make sure that both input and output have same number of key points. If they both have same number of key points, that means we have valid data in the current key point array as well as the previous key point array. So we want to look at how many key points are there in the previous one and the current one. If they're same, then we want to start displaying them. Right? So let me scroll down. So the first part we're going to do is from the key point delay element, we want to get the array, key point array, from the at index 0 and at the index minus 1, which is current and previous. And once we have that, we're going to query, we want to get number of key points in the previous array. So this is going to be very similar to what we did in the step 1. Let me try to scroll to the right so you can see the whole thing. So VX size, you're basically going to query from the previous key points the attribute num items, which kind of tells you how many key point entries are there in the array. And if the previous number of item, basically number of corners in there, is greater than 0. Right? This guarantees that if the previous one has greater than 0, current one will always be greater than 0, because optical flow is not going to remove any items. It's going to say this key point item is not tracked, but it still gives you each item. It's kind of one-to-one correspondence between the current one and the previous one. So once we have once we know number of entries, so all we're going to do is we're going to simply do access array range to get access to the key points in the previous key point array and the current key point array. And then using the similar VX array item macro, we're going to get access to both of them. Now the important thing is, what is the key point structure? Let's look at the key point structure and then see what is the data that we need to draw. What we want to show is, since we got it running, let me show you output as how it looks. Oh boy. I did something. I did select the solution. I think I have a syntax error in there.
Everything anyway, so maybe the problem is in the previous source code.
Yeah, I think what I did is, let me just make sure this runs. Yeah, I left the previous one in the middle. So if you kind of see, at every key point, you see a point and then an arrow. That kind of tells you that key point has moved from previous frame to the current frame and how much it has moved. So the way it does is, for each of the item in the array, it looks at the XY values in the previous array, in the previous time, and the current time. It looks at both of them and simply draws an arrow. That's all it does. And
is there a way to visualize the data flow graph that you have been building?
Is there a way to visualize the graph after you built it? The standard does not provide, but there are third-party tools that you have to use to be able to do that. Let's see. So there is an XML way. If we have an XML extension which we can use to export the complete context into an XML format, and if you have a tool that can take XML and then view it, that's one way. And then AMD has our own RunVX tool, which we have an option to be able to dump a GDF. You can view it textually. I'm not sure. I'm sure NVIDIA might have some tool like that too. Yeah.
So it's more vendor specific. We don't have any standard way.
I see.
So I'm going to open this key point structure. just to go over the various fields in there. You have x and y, which kind of gives you x and y coordinates in integer. And there's a field called tracking status. What Harris corners gives is tracking status to be true whenever every time it finds a corner in there. And then it gives you how strong the corner is, the strength field. And rest of them, scale, orientation, error, you can ignore them from Harris. Now, what optical flow kernel does is it just takes the x and y values. After it tracks, it looks to see if it has lost the point. If it cannot track anymore, it sets the tracking status to be false. That's how you know a point is tracked or not. Right? We're going to use the tracking status field. If the tracking status field is true, then we look at x and y values for the previous and current. And then that's how we kind of plot it in there. So that's the reason here. It looks at KP new tracking status. If it is true, it prints XY new value. And that function takes care of the GUI. And then once we are done with it, you can just simply commit saying we don't need it anymore. That's a part of displaying. Now, the last part is within each frame, after you're done displaying, now you want to kind of take the current pyramid and you want to move it to this previous. Similarly, current key point array and make it as previous one. So how do you do that? We have two delay elements. You simply call age delay for both of them. That takes care of cycling it through. Right? And after that, this is all just simple maintenance code to look at it. Any other questions?
Where do we drop points?
Okay. So if you look here, if the tracking status is true, there's a draw arrow.
Yeah, but the points, the red points.
That's done part of draw arrow function. Yeah, draw arrow is just a OpenCV function that just draws a circle and an arrow. Kind of thing.
Yeah. Yeah, because sometimes you have points on the, but it's because they don't move, so the arrow is very smart. So everything is an arrow.
And there's one more thing I want to mention. There's actually two more points. This is kind of is an important feature of OpenVX where you can query the performance of a graph execution. So there is every graph has an attribute. It's called VX graph attribute performance, which kind of gives you a data structure that looks like VX perf T. That's a type of it. You can query the performance of both. And it's again implementation dependent in terms of how it gathers all the data. All the specification guarantees is when you query, you get the performance data. And it has various fields that you can query. You can print how many times the graph has executed, what is the average time. And the time you can see is kind of in nanoseconds. In 1.0.1, it is not explicitly mentioned, but that's how we all implemented it. But in 1.1, we did mention the units. That way it gets more portable across. Right? And it has average value, minimum value, maximum value, and also the last measurement. That's it. This code just measures that. Let me just go over the actual structure. You can kind of see all the measurements here. Average, min, max, number, and the sum. And that's it. And after that, all you do is release all the objects, very similar to what you did in exercise one.
So that the performance, that's implemented by the vendor, and is that a running average or is that a cumulative average? Is it biased towards the latter parts of the run or is it?
Well, spec says average, I'm assuming it means the whole average, yeah. There's no weighted towards, it's a from sum divided by total.
Yes, like frame by frame.
So every time you ask for the attribute, you get the data up to that particular time. Let's say you ran first time, you get it for one frame. Next time you query the attribute, you get it for two frames, the sum and the average and the min and the max. If you query it after, let's say, 1,000 frames, you get all the data aggregated towards that 1,000. Bye. Any other questions? So great, that completes the step 2. I think now we're ahead of schedule.